So let me ask you this question. How many of you have never been to an ICM banquet before? If you have never been to an ICM banquet before, let me tell you a little bit of secret. You are in an enchanted place. This is where the magic happens. It was not so many years ago that right here in this room, we had five women from the Philippines that had kind of overcome a lot of poverty, and they were kind of sitting right over here, and then we did an MTV-style video, a music video, and then they appeared live on stage. Those ladies could really sing. It was impressive. And then it was not long after that we did a music video. A whole musical. That was the year that Michal wrote did all the videos, and Louise wrote all the music, and we had live performances from the participants, and that just brought the year down, the whole house down that year. And then right over here on these steps was the year that one of the years with the ICM choir performed for the very first time in their lives. And since then, they've performed 250 times. They've done two trips around the world. And in this room, we have shared a few tears together. We have shared moments of incredible joy. And tonight, across all the Philippines, we've got 10 different provinces, 500 full-time staff, and they are all watching what happens here live because they want to see what magic might happen here tonight. Right here in this room, we celebrated the graduation of 500,000 participants. And then the next year, we celebrated the graduation of 1 million. And we are soon going to graduate one and a quarter million people from our four-month Transform program. We are kind of reaching a scale that very few charities in the world are able to achieve. And ICM remains a Hong Kong charity. Our board is based in Hong Kong. Almost all of our funders are based in Hong Kong. So it really all starts right here with all the people that are right here in this room. It's pretty cool, isn't it? See something of that scale. It's a lot of magic. But ICM is not slowing down. We hope to cross our second millionth graduate within 3 years. And if you've been around ICM for very long, you'll know that we don't do business, our charity, like a lot of other charities do. We take a business approach to fighting poverty. We research, we measure, we innovate, we scale. We're focused on being effective and efficient. And together with the people in this room, we've made a few decisions. We've decided that we're only going to focus on the poorest people in the world, the ultra poverty, that lowest level. Just to give you a little context, in the international community, they focus usually on extreme poverty. Extreme poverty is $1.90 a day, and the UN says that that is a level that threatens someone's survival. At ICM, we decide to focus on ultra poverty. Ultra poverty is 50 cents a day, one quarter of the standard of extreme poverty. How do you find all those people? You know, at this point, most of the world's population lives in cities, but the hardest to reach people often are in the most remote places. There's 100 million people in the Philippines, 7 million are ultra poor. That's our target. And those people are spread all through the country with just a few dozen households here and there in each different municipality. They're hard to reach, but they live in conditions that really no human being should be forced to endure. And ICM, we work with wherever the poorest people are. Our staff go to great lengths to visit those poorest people. Today, this evening, just in the next few minutes, I want to take you to three different communities. So a mountain community, a farming community, and fishing. They're quite different demographics. First, let me take you to a mountain village north of General Santos in Mindanao. There's a woman there named Diana, and her family has a farm, a small farm, and that's what they do. They run this small banana plantation. They earn $80 every time they gather in the bananas. You know how often they do that? Three times a year. So that means they live for a whole year on less than $250 for a six-person family. That is, feeding their family is a real struggle. In fact, in their whole community, almost everyone struggles to get three meals a day. And that's not unusual in the communities that we work with. About 22% of our participants say they go to bed hungry at least once every week. There's another woman in that community, her neighbor, Diana's neighbor, her name is Candy, and she has had five children now. Now, she actually gave birth to six children, but one of her children tragically passed away in the first few months of life. And unfortunately, that is also far too common in our communities. In fact, of all of the problem statistics around poverty, the one that strikes me the most is this one. 32% of all of the women that we work with have had one of their own children die. 32%, one-third. And in fact, 8% of the mothers that we work with have had more than one of their own children die. That is just a haunting reality. Mary Joy is another woman in that community. She has a family of five. She says she can't afford her own home, so the family lives with her relatives, and they live in this small hut. 61% of ICM participants live in cramped homes. Now, we in Hong Kong think that's just hilarious, cramped homes. Huh? You don't know what cramped homes is. But I think maybe it's a little different. The definition of cramped homes is this. If you have a 1,000-square-foot flat, you have room for 50 full-time people in your house. That's what a cramped home is. And we got 61% of the people are like that. Second, let me take you to one second community. It's a farming village. Marvin's father, he works for a sugarcane plantation at subsistence wages. When Marvin was 12 years old, his mother got sick, and they took out loans to pay her medical bills. But she unfortunately passed away anyway. And now it's been a decade later, and the loan repayment is still coming out of his father's meager salary. Marvin's classmate is a guy named CJ, and last year he was forced to drop out of school for a whole year to help his family earn income for food, but now he has rejoined school. He's now in the 11th grade, should be in the 12th grade, and he really wants to finish school, but his father is pressuring him to drop out so that his family can be more comfortable and be sure that they have food on the table. Only 17% of ICM adults have graduated from high school. Another guy named Urban, he's the seventh of nine children. And Urban is trying to finish his studies, but he too has to be pulled away during the harvest season. The third community I want to tell you about is fishing villages. This is Ipo, a remote part of Mindanao. And Chona's extended family, she lives along the shore, so they can see water, but they have no running water. And she ends up spending 10% of all of her income just to buy water for drinking, for washing, for daily hygiene. 53% of our participants aren't able to purify their water before they drink. In 2016, a woman named Jayanne, right next door, her home was seriously damaged in a storm, and they've not been able to restore it yet. 31% of our people live in scrap roofs. 32% live dirt floors. And their neighbor named Lynn, she has four children. Now, 3 years ago, Lynn's husband passed away, and it left her as the sole provider for her children. They're really struggling. One of her children, named Maria Audrell, is that little girl is partially deaf, and not only can she not hear, but she suffers from pain in her ears, and she's done it for many years. 10% of ICM participants are seriously ill at any given time. But what does that all mean for the daily life of an ultra-poor person? Well, Filipinos, you probably know, eat rice. That is their primary sustenance. And a single kilo of rice, not that much rice, it is just barely enough for six people to eat. And 1 kilo of rice costs, let's call it about 80 cents if you get the lower quality. If you add then about 10 U.S. cents for six tiny little dried fish, and then maybe 2 cents for cooking oil, and that is the whole cost of one meal, about 90 cents for one meal. To do three meals, they basically do that three times a day. So that means three meals is about a little less than $3 for the day to get the absolute minimum level of subsistence. That means rice is what they eat virtually every single meal, all day long, every day. And then, aside from that little bit of rice, the other thing that that six-person family needs is, everything else you put it together, they can do it for about a dollar a day for six people. That includes their education expenses, soap, shampoo, electricity, water, clothes, essential hygiene products. And so that average six-person family, $3 a day for food and another dollar for everything else. And so they need about $4. But the average ICM family actually only earns $2 a day. Now, if you were the head of that family and you were managing the family's business, how exactly would you go about balancing that budget? What would you decide to do? Well, you would have no choice but to consume less food, right? You've only got $2. You need $3 just for food, and so you'll do less of that. But what else do you do? Actually, one of the families I just talked to you about, I talked to her yesterday, and she said, yeah, we almost never eat breakfast in our household. We just don't have any money, even for the children. There's no food for breakfast. Now, but then that's not enough, so what else do you do? You go without water? Do you keep the kids home from school so you don't have to pay for their transport costs, or no electricity for the house? I mean, ultra-poverty, it just creates haunting choices for the adults in those households, and it afflicts not just a few people, it afflicts millions and millions of people. Now, if you were in my position or someone like me, and you were the CEO of a charity like ICM, and your job was to try to help millions of people fight ultra-poverty, how would you even go about doing that? Now, ICM, we're in our 26th year, and we've done a couple of decades of trial and error, and I feel that we have tried almost every solution imaginable one way or another. Maybe we didn't execute well, but we've tried a lot of things. And after two decades of trial and error, we have gathered 100 million data points on our participants to try to understand what works. And that data, you add it all up, and we have come to this conviction, which is a little countercultural in the development community. We are convinced that a four-month anti-training program gives the highest return on investment to fight ultra-poverty. So we've designed that program, we call it Transform, and it's a simple concept. It's integrated the whole thing into one, but it has dozens of moving parts. So how best to explain that program? So what we did is we went to a local marketing firm named Profit, and we asked for their pro bono help, and they helped us design this box right here, this little cube. And this is designed to help you or anyone understand what ICM does. And we're going to give you a copy of one of these a little bit later, but this is not a Rubik's cube. This is what they call an infinity cube, so it kind of goes in the same direction, and so you can't get too lost. So if you look at the front of the cube, it says hope is the answer and that ICM's focus is on people that earn less than 50 U.S. cents a day. And if you look at the back of that cube, you see the backbone of our program. The top half talks about our pastor network, and that is how we distribute our product. Now, when you go to the Philippines, if you go there, and you were to look much demographically, you would see no matter where you go, no matter if you go to the farthest away mountains or the deep in the most worst urban slums, there is always a tiny little church there. And the pastors, they permeate the entire country. They provide ICM with the access to the poorest people. It would not be possible for us to replicate the distribution network we get with the pastors by hiring secular social workers, no matter how much money we had, even if you had unlimited resources. And those local pastors not only are they already there, but they are deeply motivated to help the people in their communities. They feel that reaching the poor in their community, it is their calling. And ICM has gone through many ways to kind of engage those, and we have eventually designed this program, we call it Thrive, and now we are actively engaging on a regular monthly basis with 6,200 different pastors that are serving that many people from 86 distribution points that ICM created. Now, when we award a Transform program to a local pastor, he or she, they end up training 6 local counselors from their community. And then each local pastor invites the 30 poorest people in their community into a once-a-week training program that lasts for 4 months. Once a week for 4 months. And during that training program, the pastor, alongside the ICM Health and the Livelihood staff, that's what they do, and that's what they run. And so let me unpack what they deliver. So this box contains what we call hope. And hope is spelled H-O-P-E. And the first thing that you do when you open the box is you come to the H level. H is for heart. Now, progress out of poverty begins with the belief that change is possible. Transform begins with a focus on the heart, love, forgiveness, family, self-worth. Now, these sorts of concepts are very important. From our comfortable lives, we often expect that the ultra-poor will jump at any chance to improve their livelihoods, but many of them don't. And why is that? Because when you live in extreme and ultra-poverty, living life is traumatic. Sickness, hunger, disasters, they're all part of the fabric of daily life. Many of the poor feel hopeless, and they are paralyzed by what is essentially post-traumatic stress disorders. Many of them are afraid to try anything new. And as I said, our two decades of research has convinced us that hope is the essential precondition to true change. Hope is very powerful. And even if you want to deliver hope, how would you go about doing that? Well, we've determined that our hope program is effective at creating hope. Based on a battery of survey questions that we ask all of our participants, we see a 41% improvement in an index of questions we call the Hope Index. We see a 43% increase in self-worth. Now, here on the board is a chart, and that is a chart of one of our communities, and every one of those little dots is a human being, and you can see the connections between the people. And you'll see that some of these people have very few friends. And on the right, then, is that same chart after they go through 4 months of training and care for each other. Here you begin to see a community that really cares for each other. So reaching out to hope unlocks fear, and it brings participants into supportive communities. Hope is the key to start. Now, once you go back to your cube, and then you come to the second opening, and the second face, the letter of hope is O, and that's for opportunity. Now, opportunity is that second face, and at Transform, we create opportunities for people to earn more income and save for the future. So ICM's participants launched 30,000 new businesses with a 92% repayment rate on microloans. The average ultra-poor graduate experiences a 106% increase in their household income. Now, I don't know if that sounds like a lot to you, but for someone who earns less than 50 cents a day, doubling their income is a big deal. The next face of the box, of the cube, is a little bit smaller, and this is where we say hope has to be sustainable. So the participants join savings groups, with each saving a couple of a cents per day. And after a few months, the collective savings grows. At the end of just those 4 months, the average savings group in our communities has saved $50. That's an extraordinary amount for a small group of people that earn 50 cents a day. And then at the end of that 4 months, we don't abandon them. We actually we invite the heads of all the savings groups into a monthly meeting we call Prevail. And at the Prevail Network, we're now providing monthly support to 1,400 different savings groups. And they have gathered, those groups together have generated a cumulative saving of nearly $500,000 U.S. dollars. And those the saving in each community grows quite quickly. After 4 months, it was $50. The average group that has been with us for about a year and a half is up to $343 of savings from their own savings. And after seeing many of these groups form into large cooperatives, and then those large cooperatives have thousands of dollars in each of those groups for savings, then you turn the cube to the next letter, and it's the letter P, and that stands for physical. So Transform also addresses physical health needs. There is such a big difference between my world and those who live in ultra poverty. My wife and I, Deanna, we just welcomed our second granddaughter to this world. Her name is Zoe, and she's in North Carolina, and she was very healthy, but her bilirubin count was just a little bit low at birth, and so as a precaution, the U.S. doctors decided to give her this high-tech phototherapy to prevent jaundice, and I felt like we were in a sci-fi movie, but the thing is, her bilirubin counts were still in the normal range, so she didn't even need it, but I'm happy to say that both of my granddaughters are doing great. And that was just a couple weeks ago, but I got to tell you, when I go to the poor communities, I see such a huge difference. The ultra-poor are forced to suffer through such limited health care. One health crisis can wipe out an entire family's progress out of poverty. ICM addresses these physical needs, health needs, in two different ways. We teach and we treat. We teach primary health education, disease prevention, sanitation, early childhood health. We see a 28% reduction in serious illness, a 90% decrease in chronic hunger. And we also treat health needs in the community. 1,400 children suffering from malnutrition, 40,000 screened for tuberculosis. We've managed 1,400 high-risk pregnancies, and we have treated more than 16,000 children for parasites and deworming. But Hope's last letter is the letter E, and that's for education. Now, poor children are often left behind in the classroom, and they're more likely to drop out. Half don't continue past elementary school, 80% don't finish high school. Over the last few years, many of you in this room know that ICM has been experimenting with a program we call it Family Academy to help these children develop a lifetime of learning. We send in ICM coaches, and then they train each of the parents of preschoolers in our communities. And we train the parents to teach their own children, their own preschool children. And that training now, our evidence would say, doubles the child's score in both math and phonics. But there's something more fundamental we're doing. Sociologists talk about something called the 30 million word gap. Sociologists say across the world, a rich parent will speak to their own child 30 million more words before they go to kindergarten than the average poor parent. And many sociologists say that lack of parental attention is one of the primary causes of underachievement among poor children. Well, ICM's Family Academy addresses that problem. We spend a lot of time with the parents in the Family Academy, and the Family Academy parents end up spending a lot more time with their children than if they hadn't been through Family Academy. The parents of Family Academy are three times more likely to believe that their own child will go to college. We believe that evidence, when we eventually get to the end and do all of our research, the evidence will show that changing the parents' behavior to their child, will even be more impact than all the math and vocabulary lessons that we give to the child. There's a lot more research to come for us, and I want to thank all of you who have supported ICM through our pilot project. We're planning to expand Family Academy to more Transform communities this year, maybe all of our Transform communities. Those four elements, the heart, opportunity, physical, health, education, that's how we spell hope at ICM. Each of those H-O-P-E letters, we could actually run a program which only did one of those. And like we could, for example, go into the poor communities and just run an education program for the kids. Or we could go to the poor communities and only run a medical program for the kids. Or we could go to the poor communities and only run a micro savings program for the kids. And if we did that, each one of those programs would be a really great program. But we'd be going all the way into the remote areas to reach these ultra-poor people. And if we can do that and combine heart, opportunity, physical, and education into one box, into one training program, then that's where you're going to get the most effective way to bring real life change to those poor people. That gives us a phenomenally efficient platform. We were able to bring a Filipino family member through the entire four-month training program, fully loaded with all the overheads, for a total of $10. Now, maybe some of you have heard me say this before, but we are talking about $10, not $10 per month, not $10 per year, $10 period for each ultra-poor family member. We measure at ICM. We innovate. We believe we can always do better tomorrow than we did yesterday. We pour through those 100 million data points regularly. And as ICM has grown, we have not become bloated. In fact, our unit costs of helping each person are decreasing every year as we achieve economies of scale. And we expect our unit costs to continue to fall as we go forward. Now, when ICM does deliver that kind of hope, the results can be quite astonishing. In the mountain community I mentioned earlier, the transformed community started a savings group, and Candy has savings for the first time in entire life. Before that, she said every time at the beginning of the school year when the classes start, then she had to go into debt in order to pay for books and uniforms for her kids, but she says the next time the school year starts, then she won't have to borrow. Mary Joy started her own vegetable garden, and now she can feed her kids more nutritious food. Diana's children, they benefited from Family Academy. She says she feels much more confident as a mother now that she knows how to teach her own children at home. In the farming community, CJ's grandmother has been part of ICM for 3 years, and she started her own business, buying and selling snacks. She's able to support CJ's education. And in the fishing community, Chona's savings group has nearly 40 members now, $150 of their own savings, and they're about to launch a business together to sell piglets. Lynn has also launched her very own business. She's selling cakes. Since her husband died, she has to provide for her children herself, and she used her initial sales proceeds to buy some new equipment, and now she runs a business from home, and she's still able to care for her kids. Transform, she says, gave her courage. She believes in herself, and for the first time since her husband died 5 years ago, she says, I'm finally at peace. That's amazing changes. Now, these are just a handful of stories. How do you scale something like this further? It wasn't so long ago that we were in this room and ICM was just a small charity beginning to grow, but with your support, ICM is now one of the largest charities in the entire country of the Philippines. From the beginning, we've always said that our aspiration has been to reach the entire central and southern parts of the country. It's not a small task to be in every single village in a large part of the country, but we're getting closer. Look at these maps. We call these saturation maps. There's the country. The top half is Luzon, the middle part is the Visayas, and the bottom part is Mindanao. And you can see that ICM already has about 60% of the Visayas in our saturation and about 30% of Mindanao. Now, if you zoom in a little bit more into the Visayas, you can see a lot more, and these are all of our pastors and our programs. And if you zoom into the island of Negros, and all those dots are places that we have run a transform program, each time with 200 family members. And now if you zoom down to the city of Bacolod itself, here each one of those political subdivisions are quite small, and we can see every pastor, every transform down to the smallest political subdivisions. So we're beginning to use these kinds of saturation maps to really be sure that we are not missing any holes, that we are genuinely trying to fill all the gaps. And we are coming really close to genuinely saturating the areas that we're in. Extraordinary thing happened a couple of months ago. ICM received a really large grant from Old Dart Foundation in the UK. And they said, what we want ICM to do is we want you to expand across all of the Visayas within 3 years. Extraordinary reach. Only catch is this. Old Dart said, we're not going to give ICM the resources to continue to grow bigger if you're not able to sustain your existing source of funding. So our existing funding is more important than ever. Now, in addition, with that success with Old Dart, we actually have some access to a few other foundations we think would be open to potentially funding us to saturate all of Mindanao as well on a similar sort of strategy. But those big foundations will only provide the resources on the condition that ICM's core funding is still strong. We don't need huge increases in our historical core funding, but we do need to be sure that it's strong. Now, ICM's historical support has been gifts usually from Hong Kong financial services professionals, and those gifts are usually between $2,000 and $10,000. That's kind of our sweet spot here. So the people in this very room are the people that can make that happen. Now, many of you have been our partners for many years, and our vision is to reach the poorest, and we feel like that is just as much your vision as it is ours. And we hope that you're really proud of what's happening here. We're not quite ready for expansion to another country yet, out of the Philippines, but we're getting closer, and hopefully we'll be able to tell you a little bit more about that soon. So this evening, a little bit later, we will be asking you to consider investing in ICM. Any donation that you choose to make will bear no costs outside of the Philippines. ICM covers all of the costs outside the Philippines from designated donations, so 100% of your donations go straight to where the poor people are. And if you're a donor that's looking for multiplied impact, you are in the right place. Tonight, we've got a different foundation in the U.S., and they're called Us Find Us Faithful. They have offered to match every donation of $10,000, $80,000 Hong Kong. They're not going to match it once. They will match it twice, which means that if you make a donation of $10,000, then Find Us Faithful will donate an additional $20,000. So your $10,000 will mobilize $30,000 of resources for the poor. Now, their matching grant is good for $500,000, quite extraordinary, and we are grateful to Find Us Faithful for that. They are watching us now from Oklahoma, so would you do me a favor and give me a little clap to say thank you to Find Us Faithful? Thank you very much. Listen, we at ICM, we hold ourselves to the highest levels of accountability. Data is not only for research, but it's also to give our donors confidence that you are making a difference. Here's some data in action. When you sponsor a Transform program, your donation gets identified to the specific community, and every single poor person in that community also gets a unique ID. Each donor gets a profile of their own specific area, a photo of the specific people you're helping with your donor's name on the banner, and you'll get a thank you card signed by the very specific people that you are helping, and lots more. And we track every single person in your community, how often they attend this Wednesday, next Wednesday, which one of the poor people started a business. Is there any malnourished child in your community? If so, what was that child's weight on a weekly basis? We track this level of detail for every single Transform community we do, and we run 1,300 communities every year. We are touching 250,000 family members on that basis. Now, why do we go about keeping this level of detail? We care about effectiveness, but we also want you as a donor to be absolutely sure that your donation is having concrete, measurable impact on a gritty and a personal scale. Because every investment you make will change someone's life, some real specific person. Those who endure the horrors of poverty, they are not statistics. They are a people with a face and a name and a dream and a whole life of potential. People like Candy, who overcame her Candy over here is overcame the loss of her child, and she provides historically for her kids. I need some light on Candy. There we go. Or someone like CJ in the front here, and CJ is fighting to stay in school against all the odds. Jan is over here, and she dreams of passing her board exams. Mary Joy is right up here. She wants to build her own home. And Chona is over here. And Chona's over here, and she's overcome abusive employers. And Urban is up here, and he wants to provide hope for all of his siblings. And Diana is back here, and she grew up without a mother, but she's an amazing mother herself. And Marvin's up here. He's hoping to work overseas one day. And then we have Lynn right here on the center stage with me. Lynn has Lynn has overcome some tremendous hardships. She's a widow, and she's got sick children, but now she makes enough money for her own children. So these are just nine people that you've been able to help with your donations to Transformers. So thank you very much. So those quick stories are just representatives of more than a million people that that ICM has been able to reach through your point. But honestly, they are representative, but they were not chosen at random. Filipinos love to dance. And over the last few months, we've been running dance competitions in all of ICM's bases. And we invited all the different poor people to come in, and they went through a dance. And teams came from far and wide to these dance competitions. And each dancer was from an ICM program. And some did traditional dances from their provinces. And others were more modern. And some of them got all dressed up. And they were hoping to win a regional prize. But in the end, three teams really emerged as the winners. And tonight, we want to bring those three teams to you to see for the grand finale. So they can't really wait to show you their moves, so they want to win the prize. So listen, you as the audience are going to be voting on the winner here tonight. So let's just meet the three teams real quickly over here. Daniel is ICM COO. Daniel, who's with you?
Hi, Dave. I have Mary Joy. How are you? Welcome to Hong Kong. And how was your travel all the way from the mountains?
We really love it. Hong Kong is so beautiful.
And does your dancing group have a name?
We are the Coco Mamas.
Very nice, very nice. Mary Joy's community was sponsored by Wendy Barnes.
I would like to introduce you to this team right here. This is Urban right here. And Urban, he actually choreographed that dance you saw at the beginning. And Urban, how does your family feel about you being here?
They are so proud. They're actually all watching us live on YouTube now at ICM Bacolod office.
So, we're live streaming this whole event, as I mentioned earlier, and it's not just the ICM staff, but all the dancers' friends and families, they're all watching it. And Urban, what is your team's name?
We are the Sugarcane Warriors.
Carol, who's with you over there?
This is Chana. So Chana, how do you feel about your big moment tonight?
We are nervous. We're practicing 4 months, but we're going to enjoy it.
So what is the name of your team?
We live next to our river, so we are the River Dancing Queens.
Oh, yeah. Chana's team was sponsored by the Union Church of Manila in the Philippines.
Well, I know that you dancers want to get back to prepare for the performance that's going to happen soon. But before you go, we do want to announce the winning prize. We do want to say thank you to each of the three of you in a special way. We've got a donor, Joe Walsh, who's agreed to sponsor all the prizes. Each of the three members of the third place team will receive 50,000 pesos or $1,000. That's a huge amount of money for them. If they are in second place, they will receive $1,500, and if they are in first place, they will receive $2,000 for each donor. Our only rule is that the cash from all these prizes can only be used by the family members for a business, a scholarship, or to repair their home. So each team member can choose which one works for them. So we are really excited. Ladies and gentlemen, each one of you are going to be the judge, and after the performances, you'll vote for the winning team. You're using the same app that you've been using for the silent auction, so be sure you get that all signed up. One vote per phone, so no cheating, okay? And let's be sure you're registered. Will you thank me one more time and thank the dancers for us? Listen, it's not easy for one of these people to stand on stage and share their story in front of a thousand strangers, but we've gotten to know these people and these nine people, and they've shared their sorrows and their joys with great courage and dignity, so I'm really pleased with them. Now, finally, I do want to just extend my heartfelt thanks to each one of you in the room. This ICM banquet is genuinely one of the most humbling nights of the year for me. I look around the room and I see many people that I call friends, and we're embarking on this great quest together. Together we are on the next step of a journey to fight one of humanity's most perplexing problems, the problem of ultra poverty. Thanks for walking with us. You fill me with great hope. Thank you.
Count to three. Come with me and you'll be in a world of pure imagination. Take a look.
Listen, that Willy Wonka thing, that was all just a fairy tale. It was just pure imagination. At ICM, we are in the business of making dreams come true for real. So, thank you. You are in the epicenter of where all the magic happens. We're going to be back in about 45 minutes. We're going to give you time to eat the main course and talk to your friends. And in 45 minutes, we'll be back. Lot 2 of the silent auction is now open. Please enjoy your meal. Thank you very much.